Okay. So for our case presentation today, our theme for this class is biological miracle. Okay. So this is biological, as we know, bio means life, biology means study. So we more focus on the miracles of the living things. Okay. So this presentation involves three PBL groups. So first, I would like to list out the objectives that we are focused on. Okay. So first, we want to enlighten the students that Allah's miracles can be found everywhere, even the places that we least expect. Second is to appreciate Allah's creation and understand its importance as part of the biodiversity. And the third one is to extract the lessons from all the miracles and apply it practically in real life.
Dear UFS colony, this is the sign that you are waiting for. Prepare yourselves. We present to you the Queen Bee.
So welcome to our presentation today, entitled Beyond the Bell. Okay. So we are from PBL4, as I'm the first presenter, named Siti Nuan Farha binti Muhammad Nuh, with the metric number of 1519656, followed by our girls presenter, Tengku Nur Dahlia bin Tengku Nukman, with her metric number 1512368. So, first, I will talk about the colonies of bees. So I will talk about this first. Bees contain three casta. the objective first. The objective is to explore the miracle of the bee and to appreciate the beauty of Allah's creation and also to ponder the wisdom behind the bee's behavior. I will introduce you the colony of bees, which consists of three casta. The first one is the queen. So as you can see, the queen is a little bit larger and longer compared to the worker and drone. So function of the queen is to produce egg and also to maintain the unity of the colony. Second, the drone. The drone consists of only male bees, and the function is only to mate with the queen to produce bees babies. And the last span for these workers is about 8 weeks. So the third is the workers, consists only the female workers. The functions, they do all the work such as gathering the food, producing royal jelly, and also feeding the larva. And the last span for these female workers is about 6 weeks. So now we move on to the life cycle of bee, which consists of four stages: the egg, larva, pupa, and also the adult. So the egg, as you can see, for the eggs, on the day one, the queen will first lay the egg inside the hexagonal hive. As you can see, the egg is very very small and it appears like a poppy seed shape. With the superior, there's a broad opening for the penetration of sperm by the drone. And the lifespan for this egg is about 3 days before hatching and transformed into larva stage. So this larva stage lasts until day 9. So as you can see, there is no eyes or formation of the leg yet, because there is no reorganization of the tissue yet. So for about 2 to 3 days, all the larva gonna be fed on by the royal jelly. And please take note that only the fertilized egg before, which will become the next queen successor will continue feed on the royal jelly, while the rest, the workers and the drones later on, will continue feed by on honey, water and pollen. So, let's move on to the third stage, which is the pupa stage. So now you can see the formation of the eyes and the legs. And because there is already the reorganization of the tissue into three distinct parts, we have head, abdominal and also the tail. So the last knee is the adult stage. In this stage, all the three castas are already fully grown up and ready to accomplish their task. So we move on to the type of bee. In Malaysia, there is many types of bee, but we only emphasize the four famous types of bee, which are the first one, honey bee, solitary bee, carpenter bee and also bumblebee. Honeybee will further divided into three genus, which are Apis, Trigona and Melipona. Trigona, in Malay we call it lebah kemulut. Trigona is the only stingless bee among honeybee, and it is the most abundant found in Malaysia. So our presentation will focus on the Trigona because that is the only species found in the bee farm at Sungai Lembing for our project.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Okay, do you enjoy this video?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Anis. You're my supervisor, assistant and fellow friend. So next, I will continue the second part of our presentation, and I would like to bring all of you to go through the miracles of the bees. This is what we call the beyond the bud. And there are so many lessons that can be extracted from the life of the bees. And I would like to highlight three of them. The first one, the bee diet, the bee manner, and last one is the bee dance. So, is it real the bee can dance?
Yes.
Let's see. Okay, the first one, the bee diet. We are a medical student, right? So I think we should know this fact. In order for us to have a healthy body, we have to observe our diet, right? And as far as bees, they are very particular. Do you think, or do you know why the honey tastes very delicious? This is because the bee, they are very strict on their diet. You can see here the flower. Bees, they are only feed on the flowers that are clean and pure. Just like this one, this picture. In other words, if the flowers are immature, sick, diet, or unhealthy, the bees will not go for this. And they will rather fly and search for another flowers, and they will like to find the best of the flowers that are available. So what can we take from this bee? Okay, as the bee practice the principle of finding the best, go for the best, as we humans should also learn from them to go for the best. In our life, there are so many decisions that we have to make, right? There are so many paths that we have that are still for us. So in order for us to choose the path or career in our life, we should find the pure and the clean path. And by that, we can reach our destination and achieve the ultimate goal. Inshallah, hashtag Team Jannah. Alright, the choice are in your hands. Okay, the next one, I would like to all of us to actually open our eyes and learn the second lesson from the bee, which is their manner. If you are very familiar with the bee, maybe some of you have a hobby to catch the bees. Okay, you can notice the behavior of the bee while they want to enjoy their nectar from the flower. Okay, bee, when they feed on the flower, they will sit on the flower and they will sit on the most delicate part of the flower, which is the fragile one. So, they will make sure their entire weight will not sit on the flower. Means that, just like this picture, with their image. So, they will try to
keep the distance, and they are not want to damage the flowers or any part of it, the petals. Okay, so why they are why they are having this very polite manner? Just because they want to secure their relationship between the bees and the flowers. So I would like to give you a pick-up line today. What we can take from the bees is about the bees want to teach us the art in the relationship. Okay, we know that as a human, we engage with a lot of people, right? We have engagement with maybe in marriage, if you have any experience, or in business, or even, of course, the friendship. So in all our relationships, we should not put all the weight, all the burdens, all the responsibilities only for one group or only on certain people only. Everybody, each one of us, should be functioning and we should play our role respectively. So in every relationship, there must always be balance and sacrifice. Okay. And the last one, alright, the bee got talent. Okay. This is the most interesting part. Surprisingly, the bees also have their own dance. This dance has been considered by the scientists as one of the 7 wonders in the animals world. Okay, can you guess what is the dance for?
Communication.
Right, okay. So obviously this not has nothing to do with the custom or tradition of the bee world heritage. But actually this is how they communicate with each other. And there are 2 types of dance, the circular dance and wiggle dance, also known as wiggle dance. Okay, this communication is not just one to sembang, but they are trying to give pass on information regarding the location of the food. So you can see here, this is the wiggle dance, and the bees try to make a dance that can be understood on the bees, only by these colonies, and it will benefit their colonies and other colonies to actually find the same food source. So we can see how the bees is not stingy to each other. Okay. So as what we can learn from this bee dance, not the dance, but the wisdom behind it, is about the teamwork. So if the bees can work in community to build their hive, to build their life, so we can do more than that. If I would like to reflect in the nearest example, which is the life as a medical student. Along this study phase, there are some of us in the fast lane, there are some of us in the maybe slow lane, and some are still maybe stuck in the jam. Or maybe some of us are out of money to pay for the tour. So, yeah, I don't know if you understand the analogy or no. Okay. But so if we act as a team, work as a team, we can result. We can produce a great result, right? So my last pick-up line for today is: work as a team, act like a bee. a human being, we are always full of curiosity. Well, do you feel curious? How do these tiny creatures live life? And what is with all these species? Are they talking to one another? And what happens after the lights go out? Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I bid to our supervisor, Dr. Ahmad Gaik, our ancestor, Dr. Nur Sida, and Dr. Asma Halim, and to all my friends. On behalf of PBL1, I, Nur Amalina Binti Mahmud, with matric number 1512696, together with my partner, Nur Shalati Ariza, with matric number 1516962, we're going to present to all of you the biological torchlight of the nocturnal world. Now, let us dive deeply into the lives of some truly amazing creatures that share our planet, fireflies. So this is basically the outline of our presentation. I'll start the presentation with an introduction. After that, I'll explain briefly regarding the habitat and life cycle of fireflies. After that, I'll explain regarding the facts about fireflies and come to the most interesting part for this presentation, which is the love of fireflies. And then Shalati will proceed with the dark side of fireflies. And we'll discuss three issues, which are industrial manipulation, firefly-inspired invention, and disappearing fireflies. And we will end our presentation with a conclusion. So for the introduction, firefly scientific name is Lampyridae. Firefly is a beetle. It is not a fly, and obviously it is not a fire. So firefly is a winged beetle. So it has been recorded that there are more than 2,000 species worldwide, while in Malaysia there are more than 40 species. Firefly is a bioluminescent insect, meaning that it can produce light. And firefly usually lives at vegetation-covered areas such as meadows, swamps, coastal, marshes, or forests. So here are the examples of firefly's habitat. The first one is the marshes, is the swamp. So you can see that the trees are growing along the river. Fireflies really like the wet environment like this. Another example is at mangrove trees. This is where most of the firefly population in Malaysia can be found. And now, the life cycle of fireflies. I will explain briefly regarding the life cycle. So adult firefly has a very short lifespan. They live only long enough to mate and to lay eggs. And after the egg hatch, they will become into larva. And this larva live for approximately 1 year before they change into pupa. So this pupa finally will undergo a complete metamorphosis to become an adult firefly. And the cycle continues. Now, we have come to the most interesting part of this presentation. Why it is interesting? Because it is about love. Love of fireflies. Blinky, blinky, love. Male fireflies flash in the air to attract females. The flashings are actually the silent love song of the male fireflies. They are flying and flashing their hearts out. It is very amazing. But where are the females? So the females, they are just waiting down middle, surveying for their options. They have plenty of males to choose from, and these females turn out to be very picky. So I guess fireflies and humans are not much different after all.
Yeah.
So, they only choose an attractive male to mate with. So, what qualities the males must have in order for them to become attractive? So the male must have a brighter and higher flash rate. Besides, they must have the most nourishing and largest nutshell gift. So, what is this nutshell gift? Nutshell gift is a protein-packed capsule of sperm that is rich in nutrients that the male will give to female during mating. So this nutshell gift will benefit the female. Why? Because they help the female to lay more eggs. Okay, so when the female already find an attractive male, she will aim her tail in his direction and she will flash back. So the flashback is actually the sign, meaning that the female asks the male to come closer. So the male will fly closer to the female and the male will fly again. Will flash again. The male flash again because he wants to confirm whether the female really likes him or not. So, if the female still likes the male, they will start some sort of conversation. These creatures speak their love in the language of life. So when they fall in love with each other, okay, they will hook up like this and they will stay together like this all night long. Okay, so during mating, we can see that the male is busy giving the female not just only his sperm, but also the nuptial gift that I have mentioned before. So if you can zoom in closer to look at this mating pair, we can see that the male. We can see that the male is transferring the nuptial gift together. We can see the nuptial gift, the one which is red in color. So we can see that the male is transferring the nuptial gift to the female. So what we can say from the love story of fireflies, a female firefly actually used the flash signal of the male firefly to try to detect which male have the largest nuptial gift to offer. Because this nuptial gift will help the female to lay more eggs and finally produce more of her own offspring into the next generation. Can you hear me at the back? Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My name is Nur Shadiati Iza binti Muhammad Sabri with matric number of 151-6961. Okay, so I have come here to bring you to the dark side of the podcast. So we have listened before regarding the love story of the five lives and how it communicates with each other to find their soulmates. However, firefly love story is not also innocent fun. It has its dark side. Well, for the most part, in the mating love session, the adult fireflies don't get eaten because they can produce toxin, has been explained for you by the Amelina. Somewhere along the line of the evolution, a particular group of the firefly has lost their ability to make their own toxin. So, what happened to this firefly? They become vulnerable to some birds and insectivores. So, they had to steal the other toxins that is made by the other species of the firefly. So, usually, the female is the one that will steal the toxins from the male of the other species. So that's basically what is the dark side of the firefly. And how it goes, the female that doesn't have the toxin, she will go out into the night and find a couple who are having the conversation in the night language. So, okay, this is the couple, male and the female. And this is the female that doesn't have the toxin. So she, okay, the conversation, okay, is going on, the flashing over and over again. Okay, and then suddenly this female, the predator, she will sneak in and reply to the male. But what she did is she mimics exactly what this female has been saying. Okay, and then the male will then divert his attention towards the predator. But he has been lied, unfortunately. So, Okay. So, what happens next? The male will fly closer towards the female, and then, they will come close in together, close enough so that the female can reach out and grab the male. Okay. Now, what happened? She will slowly exsanguinate the male and drink the blood out from the male for over hours. Because the blood contains toxins, right? Okay. And then, the male, what happened to the male? Died. So, basically that. Okay, next, I'm going to talk about the industrial manipulation. So, basically, it is about how people make money using the firefly. Of course, as you can see from the picture, it is the Brazil firefly sighting. Like the one that we visit in Serang. Okay, in Malaysia, there are a few places that offer the service. We have the one in the Perak, in Serang, and as well the one in Kampung Kuantan in Selangor. Okay, but is it bad to make money from the firefly? Yeah, the answer is no, of course. The answer is no, because fireflies can act as an umbrella species. Umbrella species means it is a species that is used to promote the conservation of a species of organism by gaining the public sympathy. Basically, how it works is, for example, a tourist went to the firefly sighting, and then the tourist will be attracted to the unique characteristics of the firefly, and then they will start to sympathize the firefly because it is going into the extinction, and then they will start to think, oh, I don't want these species to vanish from the earth because they are so beautiful. Things like that. So that is how tourism can actually promote the conservation of the firefly. Okay, next one. Human is always finding inspiration from the surrounding. So we also have invented a few things that is inspired by the firefly. For example, the first invention is the LED emitting diode, LED. Okay, as what has been explained before by the sister Amalina, she explained that the firefly can actually emit 100% light energy, right? So, this LED diode now can actually emit 55% energy that is more efficient than the normal lamp, which is only 10% energy. And scientists actually has been trying to find the reason why firefly can actually emit 100% light energy. So it is actually due to the nanostructure of the belly of the firefly, because they have a unique structure that allow the light to be optimized and can be efficiently emitted. I don't want to go into the physics, okay?
Representing PBL3, and we will be talking about Peter, but more specifically, Peter. Okay, so now, after this presentation, hopefully all of us will be able to be more familiar with these internals, and then we will know a few of the miracles that Allah has allowed Sitaro to perform, and that we would know a few of the conditions, the harsh conditions that turtles are facing, and we should know the few things that we could do to fix the problem. So now, let's get to know the turtles. Now, do you want to hear what?
Alright, so, turtles, right? You may ask, why turtles? And I would say, why not turtles? Because turtles, or sea turtles, are actually, they represent a group of reptiles that have been around for the past 100 million years. They've been swimming in our seas, and in that time, they have been a fundamental link in the marine ecosystem. They help maintain seagrass beds, coral reefs, and you know, everybody loves turtles, so they have tremendous commercial and cultural significance. So if we want to get to know sea turtles, we have to, you know, go and visit the sea turtles. So PBR3 went to the Pusat Penerangan, the Hatchery and Conservation Center. Sorry. We went to visit the Cherasing. The Cherasing Turtle Conservation and Information Center. On the 5th of March, and today we're going to share the things that we saw as well as the things that we learned. In order for us to be able to appreciate the coming part, we have to know a little bit about the life cycle, just a little bit. So we start off when the female will lay the eggs on the beach at night, and after a certain incubation period for, you know, depending on the species, these eggs will hatch and we will get our baby turtles. And these baby turtles will have to make their way from the beach all the way into the ocean currents. And there in the ocean currents, they will swim around very happily for a few years, until they are older and more and mature enough to come back to the coastal waters, where they're going to take another few more decades to mature into a nice big adult, where they are able to reproduce, and the female turtles will come back to their original beach and lay eggs. So we learned in Cherasing that Malaysia is actually home to 4 out of 7 sea turtles in the world. And I will be talking about all 4 of them, don't worry. And can anybody guess what species of sea turtles these are? These baby hatchlings? Somebody has already said the answer, but we will see in a short while. So we'll start off with the biggest turtle in the world. And the biggest turtle in Malaysia. Does anybody have an idea about its name? Yes. The leatherback turtle, or the penyu belimbing, because it kind of looks like a belimbing or a soft root. Right. And the amazing thing about the leatherback turtle is that it's not only the largest marine turtle, it's also one of the largest living reptiles. And you can easily distinguish it by its shell earlier, the leathery carapace, as well as the long front flippers. So here it's happily chomping on a jellyfish. And then here is another picture to show the size. But maybe we still can't appreciate it. So could I have Aklan stand up, please? If a leatherback turtle, yes please, were to stand up, it would be the size of Aklan. Probably, yes. Because even the largest ever recorded turtle was 2.5 meters. Aklan is almost 2 meters, I guess. So, sorry. So, there's your size. And from the biggest
we go to the smallest, the cute turtle called the olive ridley turtle, also known as Panin Itan. Cockroach turtle, I'm not sure why. But they are the smallest marine turtle, and they are named so because of the olive colour of their carapace or upper shell. And, right, this is a video of somebody's feet in trotting. And this is a pool of, can anybody guess? Green turtles. Penyu agar or green turtles in trotting. So, why are they called green turtles? Because they're obviously, you know, black or greenish yellow. They are named so because of the cartilage and fat deposits. And out of these four species of turtles that I'll talk about, the most abundant is the green turtles. And you can find them in Sabah, Sarawak, Terengganu, Pahang, Johor and Perak. They are the most abundant. Here are a few more pictures of the turtles in Trotting. And if you notice, foreigners tend to like to buy keychains of green turtles because that's the merchandise. Oh, no, I ruined the surprise. Okay, does anybody pretend you didn't?
It's very beautiful, and look at that. It's very beautiful, isn't it? It's gorgeous. And don't you think it would make a nice necklace, or wouldn't you like to put this on your wall just to show it off to your visitors?
Yes,
normal people would say, no, just leave the turtle alone. But because of their thin, flexible, highly colored, beautiful shells, some people have taken the hawksbill turtle for commercial use. And because of that, they've become critically endangered. And the reason why they are called hawksbill is because of their narrow, pointed beak, reminiscent of a bird of prey, or eagles, or hawks. Yes, bird of prey. Now, have you ever noticed something about our 20 ringgit banknote? It's got turtles! And can anybody guess the species out of all the hawksbill? And? Yeah, very nice. Hawksbill and leatherback. You can see that the hawksbill, the beak right here, and you can see the shell of the leatherback right here. And I'd like to finish with a statement from the National Bank's website, because this will be important later on. And they stated that for the 20 ringgit banknote, they decided to, on the theme of marine life, these gentle turtles are a reminder that their existence rests in the delicate balance of human activity and marine life conservation. And we'll be talking about this later on, just keep that in mind, please. Thank you. Back to Fakri for the highlight of the presentation.
Okay, so now that we know a little bit more about the turtles, I'm going to be talking about three of the miracles that turtles can perform. And the first of which is their migration. Well, I don't mean the migration that the adults do in order to find food. I'm referring to the treacherous journey that every hatchling has to do immediately after the hatch. Because you see, for the first 48 hours of a turtle's life is the most crucial, but also the most dangerous. Okay, can you imagine that this area here is the deep ocean, and the area where the brothers are sitting is the shallow ocean, and the left side of the Dutch Hall is the beach. Okay. So, every turtle, as soon as they're born, they have to swim across the shallow ocean. In hopes of reaching the deep ocean. Okay, so why do they do this? Well, it's because in the deep ocean, there are very strong ocean currents that have become havens for these baby turtles. And it's also because in the deep ocean, there is an abundant source of food. And also very, very few predators. In compared to the shallow ocean, where there are many predators. And it's only after these baby turtles have grown stronger that they will return back to the shallow ocean, which is their natural habitat. Okay, so what the miracle here is that so many of these baby turtles that are defenseless are able to cross the treacherous shallow ocean and reach the deep ocean, survive, and continue species. So that's a miracle here. And the second miracle is that, as mentioned by Sister Nadia, every female turtle would return back to the very same beach that they hatched from. And they do this by utilizing the Earth's magnetic fields. Because every place, at certain times, it would have a very unique magnetic signature. So during the breeding season, the turtles will use the specific signature of every beach to pinpoint the location. And finally, the last miracle is their long lifespan. So this is just for fun. Pet turtles can live for about 10 to 80 years. But larger turtles in the ocean can easily live over 100 years. In fact, according to the Guinness Book of World Records, the oldest living turtle recorded is 152. But how do they do this, right? There are many theories, but among the most prominent one states that these turtles have a very, very slow metabolism, meaning that they grow very differently from us. They grow slowly, but continuously throughout their life, and they have no growth spurts. So in turn, they will age very differently from us. And because of this slow metabolism, they will also be able to survive for extended periods of time without food or water, meaning that they will have an advantage when the condition is harsh. And then according to the second theory, these turtles have a very healthy lifestyle. And they have a very healthy diet. Some exclusively feed on grass, some on jellyfish, but the point here is that they have a very healthy diet. And that they also live a very stress-free life. They just cruise around the shallow ocean, and they have very, very few predators. Okay. So that's all from me, Nadia. You go forward.
Okay, so Fakti may have mentioned a few of their difficulties during his presentation, but I'll be explaining a bit more. Now, I did say that Malaysia is home or endemic to four marine turtles, but according to the International Union for Conservation of Nature, the status of all four turtles, not just the hawksbill, are endangered. And the hawksbill and the leatherback turtles are critically endangered. And when we look at the population, it's very startling how drastic the drop has been in the past few decades. And when you want to ask why, we have to look back at the life cycle. So what do you think? Who is the most vulnerable here? Is it the eggs? Is it the hatchling? Is it the adults? The answer is actually all three of them, and I'll tell you why in a short while. So look at these eggs. Don't they look delicious? What about these baby turtles? Don't they look like crunchy and yummy and chewy? Unfortunately, crabs, monitor lizards, and birds think that they make a wonderful meal. So they eat the eggs, and they prey on the hatchlings once they try to make their way into the sea. And once they are in the sea, not the ocean, but the shallower water, then they are eaten by the fish instead. And let's say that somebody here said that, wow, these eggs look
delicious. Like I'm craving turtle eggs. If there is excessive egg collection or disturbance to the nesting beaches or the habitat, then you know that further decreases their chances of survival. Turtles actually have a naturally low survival rate, meaning that because of these natural predators, only let's say 1 out of 1,000 turtles will survive. But when there is human interference, then you know that number decreases even more. And then, what do you think the problem is when they become bigger? Not just pollution, but also fishing nets, like fishery-related mortality, where they get caught up in the nets or the fishing fleets, and then you know they can't escape, and then they die. It's very sad. And then this is a very famous image actually. What do you think? Are they jellyfish? No. Are they plastic bags? Yes. All right. So we have a turtle in this classroom, in this lecture hall. So is the turtle? What do you think? Does this look like a jellyfish or a plastic bag? I feel bad because I accidentally killed Ace the turtle, but basically my point is we can see the difference, but Ace can't. He thinks it's a jellyfish and then he would eat it and die. So pollution and coastal development also are also like one of the factors that further decrease the chances of survival. And like we said earlier, because the turtle likes to take its time, likes to relax, a stress-free life, it takes decades for them to be able to mature enough to reproduce. So if there are fewer numbers of turtles surviving into adulthood, that means there are fewer number of turtles that will be able to reproduce and continue the life cycle. So, Fakri, how do we protect the turtles?
Okay, now we know the hardship faced by turtles, and a large portion of it is caused by humans. So now, what can we do to fix the problem that we ourselves caused? Okay, first of all, we could protect and manage the turtles by first enlisting them in the endangered species list. By doing this, we can protect them from hunters and also maintain their natural habitat. Aside from that, we could establish hatcheries like the one we went to in Chongqing, because these hatcheries, the main goal is to collect eggs and nurture them so that they become strong enough before releasing them back into the ocean. And by doing this, we can increase their survival chances. Next, we could conduct research. For example, we could tag the turtles and locate their migration path so that we can pinpoint their feeding ground and their breeding ground. And when we know these grounds, we could protect these areas. And this might be typical, but it is important. We should conserve our ocean. We shouldn't throw garbage into the ocean, because this is the main problem suffered by the adult turtles. And then finally, but maybe the most important, we should educate. Because if we don't educate, people won't be aware. And when people aren't aware, they won't care. And when they don't care, no one will help. And when no one helps, well, need I say more? So, Nadia, take it away.
Alright, so in conclusion, not just for our turtles, but also for the bees and the fireflies, I'd like for us to ponder on this beautiful Juma'at. Al Jathia, verse number 3, indeed within the heavens and the earth are signs for the believers. We should take these biological miracles, from the bees dancing to the bioluminescence of fireflies, and also the turtles, the migration and so on, as signs of Allah. We should appreciate them for what they are, and we should try to emulate the wisdom. For example, bees are very diligent. Fireflies shine, and fireflies, yes, they shine, they glow in the dark, they are the hope they are the hope in the darkness, that's it, okay. And turtles, despite the odds of them crossing the beach, they still do it. The turtles still persevere despite all the predators out to get them, and even the natural survival rate. So we really should appreciate them for that. And especially in the fireflies, and especially for the fireflies and the turtles, you know, as we mentioned, they are endangered. And as mentioned in this verse, in Al-Baqarah, verse number 30, and mentioned, O Muhammad, when your Lord said to the angels, indeed, I will make upon the earth a successive authority, a khalifa. So from here, we can see that we are the khalifa, we are the successive authority, which means that we have a responsibility, an amanah, towards the earth to protect Allah's creation and correct whatever mistakes we have made in the past. So these are our references. Thank you very much for your kind attention.